Yes, I have a message for us this morning, and this is just specifically from God. You know, I know it fits into our series one way or the other, but it has nothing to do with the series. God just said, I shall talk to you about this, and that is about the Father's love. God said, tell my children, I love them. God just wants to revisit your perception of Him in your heart again. How do you perceive God? And I know that if anybody comes to you and say, do you love God? Of course, we know the answer. We all love Him. But what God is talking about today is deeper than that. It's deeper than that. And I want to believe that God is going to touch every heart so that you begin to see God the way He is to you. God wants to bring every one of us to a place in your life where you feel that He loves you, that He wants the best for you, and that you are His favorite. Yeah. You know, the third one is what we all struggle with. Okay? Because you always believe that God loves some other people better than you. And you have very good reasons. You know, you look at somebody else, things is happening for them. You look at yourself, it seems like things is not happening for you. And sometimes, you even see those people that don't even acknowledge God, don't even fear God, and it seems as if everything is rosy. It seems, that's what I'm going to call it. Because really, it's not rosy for them. It just appears like that. But sometimes we look at them, and then you look at yourself. You say, okay, God, I've been faithful. I serve you. I do this. I do that. And then you feel like, oh, okay, then maybe I'm not His favorite. That is the lie of the enemy. Every one of us, we are God's favorites. God loves us all the same. Okay? When we start talking about pleasing God, that's separate now. It's separate. But God loves us the same. When you look at parents that have many children also, you love your children the same. The only thing that is different is you might be more pleased with some than the other because of their action. Do you understand? But you love all your children. God loves every one of us the same. And I believe that every one of us will leave this place believing that. Because one of the strongest weapons that the enemy uses against the children of God is rejection. When you feel rejected by God, you cannot have a close relationship with Him. Because you cannot trust somebody that you feel have rejected you. When we are full of disappointments, you know, when you just look at your life and you when you think back, all that comes to you is just series and series of disappointment. When you are like that, you can't trust God because you don't want to be disappointed again. Is there anybody that is seated here that you love to be disappointed? No! We all want to be accepted. And the more acceptance you get from somebody, the more you love that person. The more acceptance you get from somebody, the more closer you move to the person without you even thinking about it. Automatically, you just move close to the person. But when you see that somebody rejects you, you don't want to be with that person. You don't want to be with them. That's the way you feel. Whether you say it or not, you feel that way. And God wants to fix that in our heart. Because the problem is this. The enemy have discredited God in our mind because of situations of life. Whereas, he's the one that is causing those situations. He's causing those situations and is building on them. I'm using that situation to discredit God in your mind or in my mind. We want to fix it today. Whatever you have gone through in life that is bad, God did not do it. God did not do it. You need to understand that, because if you don't, you will always have a discredit in your mind towards God. And when you have a mind like that, you cannot trust Him. Come on. You trusted someone, the person broke your heart. Trusted the person the second time, he broke your heart again. Try again the third time, but are you going to continue to trust the person? You won't. So when we view God like that, we cannot have pure faith. And we cannot trust Him. And that is what is needed to walk with God. That is what is needed to receive the blessing of God. So we need to understand the lies of the enemy and his strategy. and begin to make sure that those things that used to control us before don't control us anymore. Father loves us. Before you were born, He loves you. Praise God. Let's go to the book of Genesis. Let's start from the beginning and look at the kind of God that we serve. See who He is. Genesis 1:26. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Praise God. Who instructed God to make men? Who gave God instruction to make men? Nobody. Who prayed to God, requesting that He should make man? Nobody. God, willingly, desiring, wanting, decided by Himself, I will make man in my own image. Look, let us begin to understand who we are so that we can live as we're supposed to live upon the earth. Do you know that every other creature of God envies us? Do you know that? Some of us, we want to see angels. Some of us are even disappointed with God because we've never seen angels in our life. You know, because people come and start telling their stories. And when people are telling their angel story, then you look at yourself, you say, God, upon all my fasting and praying and waiting on you, I've never even seen one angel. Do you really love me? Do you approve of me? But don't you know that the angels envy us? God made us in His image, after His likeness. He created every other thing. Okay? And they are beautiful. There's no doubt about it. But guess what? We are like Him. And that is what makes the difference. Not only do we look like Him, we have the characteristic of God in us. Because He said, like Him, in His own image. Image is different from likeness. Right? Okay? So we were made in His image, but then we were not robots. We were made also in His likeness. We can do what God can do. Amen. The only thing is that we cannot do what God can do without Him. You can't. You have to tag on God. And what we are struggling with right now is tagging on Him. And tagging on Him all the way. But we must get to a point where we tag on God and tag on God all the way, so that we can do what He can do. And the enemy, knowing that, strategizes in our life to make us not to want to tag on God. And that's the problem we're all facing, which started right from the garden. Okay? Because when God created Adam and Eve, everything was perfect. Adam and Eve, they were tagging on God. They had nothing else influencing them but God. Whatever God wanted, that's what they did. Whatever God told them, that's what they followed. And because of it, things was working for them. There was no difficulty. And I want you to know that Adam was not sitting doing nothing. But all his effort was fruitful. You see the difference there, right? Because some people will think, oh, if we're still in the garden now, we'll just be sitting doing nothing. No, that's not it. He was tilling the ground. He was managing the garden. But every effort he put in was fruitful. Why? Because he had the relationship that he was expected to have with God. Because everything that we do flows from God. Until the enemy came, said, oh, this is too good for this man. And he went to lie to them. He said, you know, God really doesn't love you. If He loves you, why is He saying don't eat of that fruit? Let me tell you why He said don't eat. Because, so He doesn't want you to be like Him. And they believed Him. They believed Him against God. So they trusted the devil against God. And that's why most of us, that's what most of us do right now. Even though we blame Adam and Eve, you see, it's because of them that we are suffering. But if we were Adam and Eve, we probably would have done worse. Because right now, we are doing the same thing. Because we find it difficult to believe the word of God. And yet, every lie the devil tells us, we believe it. Because that's why we're afraid. That's why we're anxious. That's why we worry. Because something is telling us something, and we believe it. Why don't we believe the word instead of believing the thing that is talking to us? God loves us. God loves you. And you are his favorite. I want you to say, I'm his favorite. If I were you, I would wake up every morning saying it. I would say it in the afternoon, I would say it at night. I would say it until I believe it. You understand what I'm saying? Make your mind believe that you are God's favorite. Praise God. You are God's favorite. So the devil infiltrated Adam and Eve, and he cut them from their source. And that was the beginning of sorrow, right? They started to struggle. They started to have problems. And that's why we, many of us Christians, we are struggling. Because we are on our own. We are doing things on our own. We don't trust him enough to put everything in his hand. Whereas that is the solution to our problem. But when you love God, you will release everything to him. But the problem is, you cannot love him that much if you don't know how much he loves you. Do you understand now? The amount of love that you have for God cannot be beyond the love that you think he has for you. Trust me. When you love him, or when you know that he loves you completely, when you know that you are his favorite, you can die for him. And I'm not, you know, this is not by mouth, right? Because a lot of people say, I will die for him. I will die. Anyway, we see the example with Peter, right? Peter said, I will die for you. Did he? He denied him 3 times. So don't let us be quick to say, I will die for you. But he eventually died for him when he understood how much God loved him. Because, look, if you know that God loves you completely, when you are dying, you know that he is still with you in the process of that. That death is not painful. It's not painful. You know, somebody was telling a story of a revelation that God gave him one time. And he said that, you know, he was seeing this revelation like some Christians that were being persecuted. And he said there was a line of Christians, you know, and these people persecuting them, they were bringing them like they lined up a long line, and they'll be picking it from number 1, 2, 3, and then they will ask them, are you ready to deny Jesus? If you deny Jesus, then they release them. If they don't deny Jesus, they will just use the sword to cut off their head right there. Okay, so it was happening in that dream. And then he got to the turn of this person. And he said, when he got there, and they asked him, are you willing to deny Jesus? And he said, no. And they cut off his head. He said that the way he saw it in the dream, he was already with the Lord before they cut his head off. Do you understand what I'm saying? So he didn't feel it. That's the love of God. So when we feel bad for all these apostles that are martyred, don't feel bad for them. It's not like that. They didn't feel any pain. The Lord took them. So Jesus was telling him, he said, that's how it is. He said, never be afraid to lay down your life for me. Because that's how it is. He takes them before they even cut the head. Okay, so look, they think that they are hurting the Christian, but they can't hurt you. When we have that kind of faith, we can never be in a position where the enemy will oppress us. Because we know our God and we trust him. Psalm 8, I'm going to read from verse 1. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. Who has set thy glory above the earth? Out of the mouth of babes and suckling hast thou ordained strength because of thy enemy, that thou mightest steal the enemy and the avenger. When I consider thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and hast crowned him with glory and honor. If you look at that verse 5, the word that was there, that it should be translated as, you have made him a little lower than Elohim. But the person that translated the King James, they felt like, oh, that's taking it too high, right? So they changed it to angels. But the natural one is Elohim. And that is the right one. God made us a little lower than himself. And then he crowned us with glory and honor without anybody praying for it. That's his will. That is the will of the Father. And nobody can change it. Praise God. The devil cannot change it. That's why he's manipulating our mind. He cannot change the mind of God. He has tried over and over. And everything that the devil has done, God found a way to still bring us back to himself. Because that's what he wants. I mean, you would think, I mean, if you were a man, let's assume that you were God, right? And Adam and Eve did what they did in the garden. What will you do? You throw them out, you make another being. I mean, yes. I mean, you throw them out, you create another being that will work out for you. But God didn't do that. So that we understand how much he loves us. He said, no. This is the one that I created in my image. This is the one I want to fellowship with. This is the one that I want to have glory and honor. And I will get them back to that position by all means. And he did it. Hallelujah. He paid the uttermost price for you and for me. Let me tell you something. God cannot love you more than he loves you. Because his love for you right now is perfect. He cannot get better. This is the best. And I want you to understand that God loves you the best. When you understand it, begin to take advantage of it. You are his favorite. And this psalmist was saying, who is man? Why is God going through all this length for man? I can't answer that question. But the only thing I can say is, because that's what he wants. Praise the Lord. Aren't you happy? I always tell God, I say, Father, thank you for making me a man. I mean, when I say a man, I'm not talking about male, female right now. That's not what I'm saying. Man is male and female. The Bible says male and female created them. Okay? God made me in his image. Thank God I'm not a dog. I'm not a tree. All those things, they are beautiful. No doubt about it. But I'm the best that God has ever been created. You know what I'm saying? Thank God I'm not an angel. Praise the Lord. God made me in his image. After, we need to begin to think like that. And you also need to wake up also and thank God. Thank God for making me a man. In your image, after your likeness, there's no other creature that you have made that is like me. And that's the truth. No other creature. The angels looks at us in awe. Every of God's creature, they look at us with awe. And yet, we look at ourselves and we look down on ourselves. God must stop today. He must stop today. Because Jesus already paid the price for us to be connected back to God. So if we are born again and we've been washed by the blood of Jesus Christ, we are back to that position where Adam and Eve was before the fall. And we can be close to God like that. But we cannot be close if we do not accept and understand the kind of love he has for us. Because if we don't, then we don't trust him. Then we don't have faith. So can you walk close to somebody you don't trust? So God made us a little lower than Elohim, or a little lower than God, and crown us with glory and honor. 6. Thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hand. Thou hast put all things under his feet. This is what God has done for us. You are special. I am special. And guess what? We are mini gods. And when I say it this way, don't get me wrong. Because we're not comparing ourselves to God right now or wanting to be equal with him. Because remember, that's what Adam and Eve wanted to do. That's why they ate the fruit. He said, let us be like God so that we know good and evil. That's not what I'm saying. But what I'm saying is that because we recognize his supremacy over us, we align ourselves with him in obedience. And we walk with him. John chapter 10 verse 34. Even Jesus Christ said this. Jesus answered them, is it not written in your law, I said, ye are gods? It's written, ye are gods. We are God. We are made in his image. We are made in his likeness. But we can never forget that our authority flows from him. Because we don't have it if he doesn't give it to us. I mean, Adam and Eve, they learned their lesson, okay? Because when they had all the authority, they thought that they were all that. But at the time that God kicked them out of the garden, they realized they were naked. They had nothing. So, without God, we are naked. But with him, we are all things. And we are gods. Because he has given us all, not some, all authority, all glory. And that's why the psalmist is saying, why? Who is man that you are giving them all this? Who is man? Why are you lavishing all this thing on a man? God didn't answer. So I don't have to answer. Praise the Lord. He just said what he has done. He just said it again. He emphasized it so that you will know that that is what he has decided to do. Anybody that have problem with that can go to God. But I know what God is going to say is he's just going to say the same thing again. I've given them all power, all glory, dominion over all the works of his hand. That is his decision. He decided to do it. It's his choice. Thank God I'm God's choice. And I have no apology for it. I don't have to be apologetic about it. That's the way God designed me to be. And that is the way it's going to be forever. I will just make up my mind that the enemy will not prevent me from enjoying what I was created to be. And you will do the same too. Because it breaks the heart of God when he sees us suffering. And yet, he has made provision for us. Do you know how much it cost God to give Jesus? I mean, you know, you can add it to your prayers. Pray, God, give me the rest. Let me know how much it costs Jesus Christ. Because when you know, also it helps you with your relationship with God. If God can give Jesus, then there is nothing he cannot give you.
Hallelujah.
Amen. And I understand that. And you must understand that in your life. So that you live in that revelation. There is nothing that God, because he's giving you his best. That's why the Bible says, how much more with him will he give us all things? He's giving Jesus. He's giving Jesus. So what else will he withhold from you? Nothing. Nothing. But yet, when we withhold ourselves from him, we cannot benefit. That's the problem. And that's what we are all facing. We are all withholding ourselves from the Lord. And we all have very good reasons for doing it. We all have our stories. Stories of disappointments. Stories of issues. You know, the many waters that have gone under the bridge. You know what I'm saying? And yet, God didn't do all those things. The enemy did it so as to discredit God. So that we don't get close. Because he already knows that when you are close, he can touch you. His trick is being exposed. Let us free ourselves. Free yourself from the lie of the enemy. Free yourself from the oppression. Free yourself from the control. Don't listen to him. No matter what you are going through. Because, you see, we judge God by what is going on around us. We judge God by the way we feel. The day you wake up feeling good, you are all happy. You praise God, you worship. The day you wake up feeling bad, then it seems like God is far away. God have not even located you. God doesn't care. It's not true. God loves you perfect every day. When there is a storm, he loves you. When it is calm, he loves you. When you are passing through the waters, he loves you. When you are passing through the fire, he loves you. When you are passing through trial, he loves you. When you are passing through temptation, he loves you. You must understand that. Because when you understand it, anytime you are passing through, you will not run away from him. You run to him. Because he's the only one that has a solution. Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. God knows. Do you know? That's the question. Do you know that the thoughts that God has concerning you, not concerning me or concerning any other person, you, do you know? Because you must get to that point in your life where you know. If you don't get to that point, you cannot walk with God and you cannot be stable. Isaiah 49:15. Can a woman forget her sucking child that she should not have compassion on the son of her womb? Yea, they may forget, yet will I not forget thee. God can never forget you. He loves you. No matter what you are going through, he loves you. And guess what? Before he puts you in your mother's womb, he already have created a future for you. And it's good. Before you ever had the opportunity to do good or to do bad, he already made a good future for you. God has a good future for everyone. It's not the same, but they are all good. Psalm 139:13. For thou hast possessed my reign, thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. 15. My substance was not hid from thee when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. 16. Thine eyes did see my substance, yet being unperfect. In thy book all my members were written, which in continuance were fashioned, when as yet there was none of them. The books of the Lord concerning you was already written before your existence on the earth. And guess what? That book is good, because God never writes any bad thing. God did not write any bad book for anybody. There is a book that is written for your life in heaven, and is good. Don't you want to know it? If you want to know it, do a lot of praying in the spirit. When you pray in tongues, you are sending the angels on errands on your behalf to make sure that everything that is written in your book comes to pass. Hallelujah. So some of us that are too lazy to pray in tongues, you better wake up. Amen. You better wake up and start doing it right now. Anything that God asks us to do, there's a reason for it. If God says pray, there's a reason why he said pray. If he knows that speaking in tongues does nothing, why is he making us do it? Have you ever thought of that? Because that's what some of us do. That's why we never pray in the spirit. You get baptized, you just keep quiet. You don't even attempt to pray in the spirit. The tongue is given us for a reason. Because when you are praying in tongues, your mind is not involved. And God needed to bypass our mind, because our mind most of the time stand against God. That's why he blessed us with our future. So now, I can pray without my mind standing against me. Because if you know what you are praying about in tongues, most of us won't pray it. You won't pray it. Because sometimes it will be too big. You say, huh? This can't be true. And then you stop praying. So God has to bypass our mind. He said, pray in the spirit. Hallelujah. So when you go about praying in the spirit, you are just enforcing all those things written in your book. You are declaring it. And as you are giving power to the angels, they go around enforcing the blessing of God upon your life. Do you know that just as demons are sent to enforce curses, you know, that's how the witches do it, right? The witch doctors and all that. They curse somebody. When they put a curse on somebody, they empower an evil spirit to go and enforce that thing that they are pronounced to come to pass in the life of that person. That's how they operate. But in God's kingdom, you can do the same. You can give power to angels to enforce blessings upon your life. Some of us, we are too quiet. And our angels are sitting. They have nothing to do. They're just waiting on us. And yet, we are complaining to God that things are not going right. And because nobody is working for you, because you propose to be quiet. And when you see somebody's life blossoming and everything is just happening, say, God, how come you love this person, you don't love me? Mm-mm. He loves both of us the same. But that person has been busy working, giving work to his angels to enforce the blessing of God in his life. So I want everybody to leave this place today just praying in tongues. So when you pass by me, I'll say, well, did you say something? He said, Pastor, don't worry, I'm just busy. You know? Hallelujah. That's how much we need to speak in tongues. You just keep speaking in tongues. You're walking around the house. Your son say, oh, did you say something? Say, don't worry. I'm busy. Hallelujah. Because the more we pray in the spirit, the more we give power to the force of heaven to enforce the purpose of God in our life, to enforce the blessing of God in our life. And then we begin to see it. That's how we fall in line with the purpose of God. That's how it happens. That's how it happens. It is possible for you to walk in the will of God and to do what is written in your books. It's possible. It's just that you need to engage in making sure it happens. And why is that? Because we're in a fallen world. Okay? Because we have beings here that just don't want you to do the will of God. Okay? So, we have already discussed about spiritual warfare. It's a warfare, but we're not fighting flesh and blood. We're fighting the spirit. We cannot fight them with our own power. Our power does nothing. We need the supernatural power. So every resource that has been given to us by God, we must use it because we need it. So God have written something in your book concerning you, concerning me, and that thing is good. Hallelujah. And just to confirm this, you know, because some of us will be wondering, is it true? Is it true? Okay. Because Jesus also have a book written about him before he came. Things that he was supposed to accomplish. And it's written right here in the word of God for us also. We have it in the Old Testament. We have it in the New Testament. Psalm 40. Let's look at Psalm 40. I'm going to read from verse 6. This is a prophecy about Jesus Christ. It says, sacrifices and offering thou didst not desire. My ears have thou opened. Both offering and sin offering thou hast not required. Look at verse 7. Then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me. Verse 8. I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. I come in the volume of the book. It is written. Now, Jesus Christ, when he came, he made sure that he walked according to the volume of his book. And that's why he said, the Son can do nothing except. Now let's look at the New Testament. Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. I'm going to read from verse 5. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he seeth sacrifices and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me. In both offering and sacrifices of sin, thou hast no pleasure. Then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book, it is written of me to do thy will, O God. Above, when he says sacrifices and offering and both suffering and offering for sin, thou wouldest not, neither has pleasure therein, which are offered by the law. Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second. By the which we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. So Jesus Christ just came to express what was already written. Something is already written concerning you in heaven. And that thing that is written concerning you in heaven is good. So whoever is here and you feel that you have not experienced good in your life, this is a good news for you. Because there is good already written before you were born. And if you have not experienced it up until now, you have been hindered. You now make up your mind today that all the good that is written of you in the volume of your book must be expressed. How do you do it? Pray in the Spirit. Get closer to God. Walk with God. But what we want to deal with today is you getting to the point where you understand how much God loves you. Because if you don't understand that, you cannot sacrifice for Him. You don't even want to give Him your time. You don't want to go beyond yourself to do things for God. Why do you think that people just do the minimal things for God? I'm talking about Christians right now. They don't understand the love of God. If you understand the love of God, you give, that's why the Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And then all these things will be added unto you. If you understand the love of God, you give God first. You give Him everything. And you cannot not have anything when you give everything to God. He's going to take care of you. He does. But then, you won't know that we take care of you until you experience it. And you can only experience it when you allow Him. And you can only allow Him through trust and faith. And that is where a lot of us are falling short. We can't even trust Him enough to see Him come through for us. So that at least we have a testimony. Praise the Lord. That's why sometimes before we get there, we have the stories in the Word of God, at least to show us that He has come through for some other people before, so that we can trust Him. For example, look at the life of Job. The Bible says we have seen the end of Job, and we have seen that the Lord is pitiful and full of mercy. We are blessed to see the end. But when Job was passing through, he didn't know how it was going to end. What kept him was because he chose to trust God. And that's where all of us have to get to. Where you can trust God like that, no matter what is going on. But the only thing that can make you get there is when you understand that He loves you. Exodus 25. The love that God has for us is so much, He can't share us with any other thing. He cannot. And I know we all, most of us understand that, particularly those of us that are married. Okay? Because I don't know how liberal a spouse can get that you will tell your spouse that it's okay for your spouse to be with some other people too, and you'll be okay by it. Some people will kill for that. That's jealousy right there. Our God is jealous like that. Why? Because we are made in His image. Don't you know that God has feelings? He's jealous too. He wants us all to Himself. That is what this relationship is all about. He created us in His image, after His likeness, gave us everything. But all the things that He has given us, we express through us as we have a relationship with Him. We're not sharing Him with other things. God wants us to be loyal to Him. Exodus 25. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them or serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquities of the father upon the children unto the third and the fourth of them that hate me. So when you have things that is more important to you than God, God sees it as if you hate Him. And then, you know, don't be thinking that until you go and bow down your head in front of a graven image. That's not what we're talking about right now. We're talking about what you give attention to. What is priority in your life? What will you do anything to get, irrespective of what God is saying in His word? You know what I'm saying? You are desperate about something. You want it done, no matter what way. What is that thing? That thing is competing with God. That thing that will make you compromise the word because you just want it done, that thing is competing with God. Whatever it is, whether it's money, whether it's position, whether it's power, whether it's things, even family. It could be your spouse, it could be your children, or it could be your own self. Whatever you want so bad for yourself that will make you disregard the commandment of God or the instruction of God, that is an image. But that thing is competing with God. God is a jealous God. Exodus 34:14 also says, "For thou shalt worship no other God, for the Lord whose name is jealous is a jealous God." The name of the Lord is jealous. And we can see this also in James chapter 4. James chapter 4 from verse 4, he says, "Ye adulterer and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God?" So you see what I'm saying? It's not the Bible is not saying until you go and bow your head in front of an image. But when you love the world and you have friendship with the world, then the Bible says it's enmity against God. Why? Because the Spirit of God that is in us lusteth with envy. That's what the Bible says in verse 5. Do you think that the scripture said in vain, the Spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth unto envy? Because our God is jealous. And that's why the Bible says that you will love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And trust me, if you don't know how much God loves you, it is impossible for you to love God like that. It's impossible for you to love God like that if you don't know how much He loves you. Mark chapter 12 verse 30 says, "And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, with all thy strength. This is the first commandment." Okay, so the commandment did not only hold in the New Testament, in the Old Testament. It also hold in the New Testament because Jesus Christ said it over and over and over and over again. We must love God like that. We must be passionate. But if we must love Him, we must understand how much He loves us. Because we will love Him because He loved us first. But if we don't understand how much He loves us, then we cannot love Him back. But He loves us. He loves us to the point that He gave us the best that He has to give. Our Lord Jesus Christ. John 3:16. Very common scripture. The Bible says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life." God loves us. So loved the world. He gave us His best. He gave us His best. He gave us His best. And with Jesus Christ has also given us all things. So we need to know that the love of God for us is not defined by tribulation or trials or circumstances. That is very important. Trials will always come. Tribulation will always come. And I know that we spent a lot of teachings in the church dealing with that, but I have to revisit it again because a lot of us sees God through the veil of what we have passed through in life, and we need to let that veil come down, because when we look at God through that veil, then the way we are seeing Him is not right. God did not afflict you. God did not bring evil into your life. God is not wanting you to always suffer and suffer and suffer. That is not the will of God for you. The thought of God for you is good. And that good was already written in your book before you were put in your mother's womb. And that book stays there. When you die and you get to heaven, you will see that book there. But my prayer is that we will not wait for us to die and then realize that everything that is written in the book we didn't do. And when you see all those good things, then you'll be wondering in your mind, why did I cheat myself? So let's fix it now when we can still fix it. God has a purpose for your life. And that purpose is good for everybody. And don't think that, oh, okay, the reason why God has a bad thing for me is because, you know, I messed up. I did this, I did that. No, because sometimes we think like that too. We say, well, it would have been good for me if I didn't do this bad thing. The book was written before you had the chance to do good or bad. Now, I'm not encouraging anybody now to go and live worldly. That's not what I'm saying. But when you make mistakes, the Bible says that when you repent, God already has forgiven you and it's been put into the sea of forgetfulness. God doesn't remember anymore. So we don't have to live our life in guilt. Because when we are heavy with guilt, also we cannot trust God. Because you feel like, well, God already edged me out because I did bad. God did not edge anybody out. And if you edge yourself out by doing bad, all you need to do is come and repent. That's why we have the blood of Jesus. Okay? But then when you come, make sure you are genuine. Because repentance is turning around. The grace of God is not for you to continue in sin and just be sinning and sinning because there is grace. But when you realize your mistake and you return to God, God already has wiped your past away. That which is written in our book, we need to enforce it. And it is good. So even when you see bad things happening around you, don't get discouraged. Just go to God. God, what's going on? Hallelujah. And when God tells you something, just act on it. If the Holy Spirit convicts you and say, okay, you know what? You know, you're doing this, you're doing that, I don't like it, change. If the Holy Spirit says, my child, I'm pleased with you, be of good cheer. Hey, rest in him. Hallelujah. If God says to you, be still and know that I am God, be still. Praise the Lord. Don't be giving explanation to things that you don't even know. Like the friends of Job did to him. Right? If you read through the book of Job, it's all conversation there, back and forth, somebody proving their own point. God will never allow evil to happen to a good man. So if evil is happening to you, then it means that you have sinned. But they were wrong. The Bible says, many are the affliction of the righteous. Why are there even many? I don't know. Why should the affliction of the righteous be many? We think when we reason with our mind that if somebody is righteous, the person should have no affliction, right? That's the way we think. But if you are really righteous, you should never be afflicted. But the Bible says many are the affliction of the righteous. That's what the Bible says. But the Bible did not end there. The Lord delivers him from some of them. Hallelujah. The Lord delivers him from them all. God have your back. God have your back. No matter what you are going through. As long as your relationship is tight with him. And that's what this message wants to fix. We want to fix our relationship with God. Bring yourself to a point where you know. Not that you are considering it. You know that God loves you the best. All the time. You know that you are God's favorite all the time. You know that God already has a book full of good things that he wrote about you before you ever even cried. Do you understand what I'm saying? You know how when a baby comes out of the womb, the first thing they do is cry? Before you made that first cry, the book was already written. So if you have had some mistakes in your past, please don't think that God is dealing evil to you because of your mistakes of the past. Do you understand? The book was written before you did good or bad. And that book is still there. The thought that God has for you is that which is good, to give you a future and a hope. You are blessed. You were created in the image of God after God's likeness. You are the best that God has ever made. To the point that some people are asking, who is man that you are mindful of him? Why, God? Why? Why should it be man that is getting all these things? The creatures of God, they look at you in awe. You are the best. You are God's. We have his likeness in us. We are his image. You can do all things through him. The only thing we need to do is fix our relationship. And you know, God already have done his side. He can do more. He's given all. See, there's nothing else that God can do to win you. Because he's giving his all. So it's now left to us to allow ourselves to be won. You know, when a man is trying to woo a woman, right? You do anything, right? God has done everything. Let's be wooed by God. Let's respond. Because no matter what the man does, if the woman does not respond, there cannot be a relationship. There cannot be. So God already have done all. Let us respond to God. That's why the Bible refers to the church as the bride. We are his bride. He is wooing us and he has done all. There's nothing else that he can do. He's done all. The ball is in our court. God is looking for those that will respond. You just respond and see what is in it for you. And when I'm talking about respond right now, let me prepare you. Okay? As you begin to respond, it might seem like you are not getting any reward. Because the enemy doesn't want anybody to respond. So he's going to lift up things against you. That's why the Bible says, from the days of John the Baptist, the kingdom of God suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. So you just make up your mind. I'm going to respond to God, and I will do it with the last breath that I have. When you make up your mind like that, you will do it. I'm not saying persecutions and trials won't come while you're trying to do it. But you just stand. You just stand. You just stand. You just stand. God is enough for you. John 16, yes. John 16, 33. Jesus said, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation. But be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. You just respond to your spouse. Our spouse is Jesus. He has already overcome. Don't look at the tribulation. Don't look at the circumstances. Don't look at the, just focus your eyes on Jesus, our spouse. He has already overcome for us. And you are bound to win. 1 Corinthians 10:13 says, there hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful. We will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but we with the temptation also make a way of escape, that ye may be able to do what? Bear it. There is always a way of escape for us. Don't think that once untoward situation happens, then bad thing will come out of it, then things will be ruined. Then no. It will always come out good for you. Psalm 34:19. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth him out of them all. 2 Corinthians 4:17. For our last affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. It's only for a moment. It's only for a moment. We only make it drag when we don't trust God. Let's trust God. Let's understand the love that God has for us. God loves you. If you don't take anything away from today's teaching, take this away. God loves you. That love is so perfect, it cannot be better. And God have done everything on his own part to woo you to himself. It's now left for you to respond. And the love of God for you does not translate by what you are going through or your experience in life. And God has a book written about you. We want it to come to pass. And you can do it. Pray in tongues. Hallelujah. Let's stand on our feet.